Father, because you are the reason for the season. And I just pray, Lord, that we will celebrate it this year, Lord, with you in the center of it all. That people will know that the true meaning of Christmas is Jesus and Jesus alone. Now, Lord, as I stand before your people with what you have laid upon my heart to say, give me the strength. May the words that you have given to me that have a lodging place in those that are sit and listen. And I just pray, Lord, that we will realize and know that the greatest gift that can be given, the greatest gift that we will receive this year and every year, is to have you within our hearts and our lives. So now, Lord, strengthen me by your Spirit. I stand in weakness, but I stand for the Almighty One, who will always strengthen us and guide us. In your name, I will pray. Amen. My message this morning is based on just 8 words. It's in 2 Corinthians 9:15. Just one verse. 2 Corinthians 9, reading verse 15. And I think this is the King James Version. Thanks be unto God for his indescribable gift. Anybody got an NIV translation? What does the NIV say?
Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift.
Okay, so indescribable is there too. Okay. This is the time of year when we are concerned about choosing the right Christmas gift to give to the special people in our lives. Well, let me ask you, have you ever received an indescribable gift? Think for a moment. Some of you have many Christmases. Some of you have had just a few. Have you ever received an indescribable gift? Have you ever received a gift that was beyond description? I thought about this for a while. Many come to mind. What gift, kind of gift, would it have to be to be called indescribable? Would it be a gift that you open and look at it and say, this is just beautiful? It's something that I've wanted all of my life. And what is it? Or maybe it's a gift that carries a lot of emotional feelings with it. It was given to you by someone very special, and it was a complete surprise when you received it. You treasure it because it will always, because of many memories that you have. What would make it an indescribable gift this morning? This is my indescribable gift this morning. We were stationed in Little Bay Islands. I had no clue about this gift. Well, let me open my gifts. But he kept this one for last because it was a request of my mom. This is what she made me one Christmas. This is a quilt. And what really touched me when I opened it was made with love by my mother. I have it on my quilt rack in the end of the hallway. My heart won't let me use it. But now my mom is gone. Perhaps it's time for me to use it. Why store things up when you can get good things out of it? So now more than ever, this is an undescribed gift for me. I'll treasure it with my life. And while we were home, some of us, my brother and my sister, took things that were sentimental to them. But there's something that, as I think it was the Sergeant Major, prayed at the funeral. Loved ones can pass away, but their memories live on forever. So I'm sure, as I spoke this morning, that you too can remember an indescribable gift that has been given to you by a dear loved one, a parent, a child, that you hold very dear to you. A while back on A Good Morning America, Joan London features some gift ideas that might be called indescribable. They were extraordinary gifts that some of you might want to include on your Christmas list. And if you do, I hope I'm on your list. One of them was a Jaguar automobile. If you care to order one of these, go to the Jaguar dealer, put down $80,000 deposit, that's all. Then when the automobile is delivered, you are expected to pay the balance of $507,000. The Jaguar 220 is $587,000 automobile, and you can make they only make 250 of them a year. Joan London also mentioned that if you were to purchase such an automobile, you might as be interested in buying the wax that promises to give the ultimate shine, and a can of that would cost $3,400. I guess you can afford it. Having a $587,000 vehicle, why not spend $3,400 for car wax? A third item she mentioned was a $300,000 gold and silver toilet seat inlaid with precious stones. Of course, there were cheaper gifts for those where everything, $18,000 frisbee, a $10,000 yo-yo for your child, and a $12,000 mousetrap, and an even $27,000 pair of sunglasses. Wow. And for the proud grandparent who was wondering what to buy a new grandbaby, how about a $28,000 pacifier? Such gifts stagger our imagination, don't they? But they're not indescribable. Even though we may not be able to find words to describe them, I assure you the manufacturers can, and they spend lots of money describing on the TV and the newspaper ads to get our attention. They will seek to describe them in such appealing ways as to entice you into believing that you simply can't live without this in your life. You see, every human gift is indescribable, rather is describable by someone. In 2 Corinthians 9, Paul at first is writing about human gifts. The church in Corinth is taking up offerings to give to the poor Christians in Jerusalem. He commended them for their eagerness to help and reminds them that those who sow sparingly will also reap sparingly, but that those who sow generously will reap generously. Then he shifts his attention from human gifts to God's gift of sending Jesus to earth for us. And he cannot find words to describe that. He simply says, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Now at this time of year, we do our best to describe the wonderfulness of God's gift of Jesus to us. Musicians have composed some of the greatest music on this theme. The beautiful hymns like Joy to the World, Silent Night, Holy Night, O Little Town of Bethlehem, and the list goes on and on. Some of the greatest music our ears will ever hear were written about God's indescribable gift. Poets and painters and sculptors have taken up the tools of their trade to pay tribute to Jesus, the gift of God's love. Now Paul says, thanks be unto God for his indescribable gift. Why does Paul call Jesus indescribable? Well, let me share with you briefly this morning just four reasons. First of all, because of his nature. First of all, I believe that Paul calls Jesus indescribable because of his nature. How do you describe Jesus? What words would you choose if you were to ask to describe him this morning? How would you describe a baby born of a virgin? How do you describe God in flesh, walking upon our earth and reaching out to the hurting masses of humanity? Isaiah said that he will be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. How do you describe that? What words would you choose? How do you describe a witch's spirit when we all we have known is that which is either physical or material? How do you describe God who is all knowledge when all we have is a limited knowledge? How do you describe God who is all powerful? How do you describe the eternal? How do you describe the indescribable? Paul can't say that we can't. Words are inadequate. But many of the wisest men of the world have tried to describe Jesus. That man's attempt to describe the indescribable. Even when we bring together our greatest minds and our most intensive vocabularies, we cannot adequately describe Jesus. Why does Paul call Jesus indescribable? Secondly, because of his purpose in coming to this earth. I think Paul called Jesus indescribable because of his purpose in coming to this earth for us. The angels announced it to the shepherds. Unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. What do we celebrate at Christmas? We celebrate the fact that Jesus came into this world to save us from our sin. God saw that mankind needed saving. He saw man's inhumanity to help his fellow man. When God looked at our world, he knew that our greatest need is far more than wealth, far more than better schools, far more better than welfare system. Our greatest need is a Savior, who was Jesus Christ, the Lord. But there will never be peace on earth until every man has lifted out of sin, and their hearts have been changed, and their way of thinking has been changed. Because the Savior has come into their lives, our greatest need, friends, this morning is to be saved from the very flames of hell itself. Are you saved this morning? Are you on your way to heaven? How do you describe it? How do you put into words what God accomplished when he sent his only begotten Son to come into this cruel old world in which we are living? I think that Jesus, God's gift, is indescribable because of his nature, because of his purpose, and thirdly, because of the grace by which is given to us. And we know every gift that I give this Christmas will be given because the recipient of a gift has some claim on us. Now, you might not like the idea, but that is as honest as I know how to be. I bought a gift from my husband, or I sure will, because he's my husband. I will buy gifts for my children because they are my children. I buy gifts for my brother and my sister and their families. And we buy gifts for our family members and friends because we love them and they are our family. Now, if I buy a gift for you and you are not in my family, it is possible, probably because you bought me a gift last year and I felt that I didn't give you anything and I need to buy you one. So I owe you one this year, and thus the cycle keeps on going. If I give a gift to feed the hungry or clothe the naked, or to take care of the homeless, I do it because deep down inside I recognize that I have a debt to humanity and a feeling of obligation to them. Friends, I don't think there's ever been a need like there is in these last months for the food bank. I think Mildred said the last time they did the food bank, over 50 bags of groceries went through these doors. People are calling, they're in a bind. They have no money, they have no food. A lady called me this week. She said, my husband and I just had some frozen spaghetti. She said, I got nothing for breakfast in the morning. Next morning, we met that need. There are many people, friends, that need physical things. But the greatest need is salvation. And it's up to us to share it to others. And I believe that's one of the greatest ministries, now more than ever, is the food bank. And many families will receive that this Christmas. And I just thank the Lord for the workers that are doing this. And I'm sure you've been blessed many, many times. With that in mind, Paul says something remarkable in the fifth chapter of Romans. He says, while we were yet in our sin, while we were yet the enemies of God, Christ died for us on the cross. God gives a gift not because he feels obligated to give a gift, but because he loved for us is so overwhelming. It's not a gift, it is a gift of grace. And when you stop at the manger of Bethlehem and look at a little child, Christ child, you must realize that he is a gift of grace. Grace, grace, God's grace. And there are no words adequate enough to describe God's gift, God's grace towards us in Jesus Christ. Lastly, this morning, because of his effect on us, this is why Paul describes it as an indescribable gift. Now, what happens when I receive God's gift? When you open our gifts this Christmas, will your life be different? When you receive the gifts that have been purchased for you by loved ones, will this change your life, make you different? Or will you be the same as you always have been? However, the Bible teaches that when we accept Jesus Christ, the indescribable gift of God, that we will never be the same again because of how he affects our lives. Life takes on a new meaning when you have an encounter with God. Have you had that encounter today? If not, please don't leave him here without him. The first effect of Jesus coming into our life and our obedience to him is that we are forgiven of our sins. Now that we are perhaps be so old and so elementary, you can think, what else is new? But don't dismiss it as quickly, because when our sins are forgiven, God forgets them. Remember them no more, and bury them in the sea, deep as the sea. Because Jesus is now our Savior, our sins are forgiven. Cherish the promise with all of your heart that you are now on your way to heaven. When we accept Christ, then we are adopted into his family and is guaranteed citizenship in his kingdom. Before we were a foreigner and an alien, separated by God. But now, because we have accepted him, we are adopted sons and daughters of an almighty God. Everything that belongs to Jesus belongs to you and to me for those that are believing in him. We are brothers and sisters in God's family because we have accepted his indescribable gift. When we accept Jesus and we receive the gift of his Holy Spirit to live within us, now he will guide us and counsel us and protect us and empower us every day that we live. When we accept Christ, we receive the gift of his Holy Spirit, who will live with us forever. We are also given his peace. The only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. Not the peace of this old world, but the peace that passes all understanding. Peace that allows me to cope with everyday situations. Peace that allows me to look beyond the smog and the smog of our world to see the great pure air of Almighty God in heaven. Because of Jesus, my mansion in heaven has been paid for, a dwelling place that will last for all eternity, and that's indescribable too. I cannot adequately describe Jesus, nor can you, because someone else failed before me and he has better than I am. We cannot describe Christ adequately enough for what he has done for us. And the Apostle Paul feels the same way when he looks at Jesus and says, I can't describe him. All I can do is fall on my knees and thank him for his indescribable gift in my life. And I guess that's what we need to do this morning and during this Christmas time. To fall on our knees and thank God for his indescribable gift that he has given to us. When God looked at our confused world nearly 2,000 years ago, when he saw the Roman soldiers marching in the streets and he saw people looking for peace and meaning and depth in life, he wanted so urgently to communicate his love. But he said, how? How can I communicate my love? If I appear in person, he must have thought, if I stand before the people in all of its glory, they'll be frightened, they'll be scared. They will never feel that one can come to me and talk with me. Then they'll be like Moses who stood on the mountain and took off his shoes because he was on holy ground. If I speak, if they hear thunders of my voice, they will never grasp the words of my love. If I send legions of angels, perhaps they will not know how to respond. Maybe they will never be able to experience my love. Friends, how in the world do you describe that which is indescribable? God said, I know. I will send a little baby. Babies don't frighten people, do they? Babies are so tender and soft and helpless. Maybe they will hold the baby. We will hold them in our arms. Maybe they will be touched through soft skin of a baby's face. Maybe they will hear the gentle sighs of a baby. Maybe they will experience my love if I send a baby. So in the fullness of time, God sent his only begotten Son as a baby, indescribable, but the good news is that you don't have to be able to describe him to accept him. You just have to be warmed and changed by him. So make your journey to the manger with the shepherds this morning. Take him into your heart and accept God's indescribable gift to you. I offer him to you again this morning, and I pray that you will respond as we sing the song 99. Tell me the story of Jesus.